say, that's a deep subject.
You need a well. And even though Mom started it long ago, please don't blame her for the rest of these well, meaning ponds. Like when a friend told me he dug a hole in the backyard and filled with water, and I thought he meant well. Or when our city friends asked if the water on our rural property is healthy, and we told them we only have well water. Or how I've always thought well drillers have boring jobs. Wells. I've gotten overboard on the puns today because I want us thinking about that word. Well, story has a well in it. Wells are in the Bible a lot. People meet their couples in particular. Wells, we could say, were actually the popular pickup spots of the ancient Near East. Women came to the wells to get water, and men knew this, and so they'd find a way to be there when they did. And sometimes in the Bible, a lot of times, one thing would lead to another, and pretty soon a coupling was arranged. If we wanted some more puns, and I know that at least Denny does, we could say that our couple was well met, that their marriage was well arranged, and of course that all was well at the start. Our story today is about how Isaac and Rebekah met and got married. And it's not Isaac who goes to the well to pick a wife. It is old dad Abraham's servant. The servant is traditionally thought to be Eliezer, the name given to Abraham's head servant in Genesis 15. Isaac is apparently not allowed or unwilling to leave Canaan, the promised land. Some suggest that he cannot go for fear that the connection to it, the family's right to claim it, may be lost if he was gone and the very elderly Abraham died. Or perhaps Isaac needed a non-Canaanite spouse so that the Abrahamic claim to the land was not diluted by a Canaanite family line claim to it. But I think that for the story to work, the person who goes to Ur of Chaldeans, Abraham's home, town, and country, needed to be a stranger in order to reveal the true nature of the prospective spouse. How one dealt with strangers is a common theme in Genesis and actually much of the Bible. Whatever the reasons, Abraham is adamant that the wife Eliezer finds for Isaac feed from his dad's home. And Isaac does not do the searching for a wife. That's the servant's mission. Another curious thing about the story is that God is not named as the one guiding the process firsthand. Rather, human choices guided. Those made by Abraham, Eliezer, Rebekah, and the family. How they choose to act, especially towards strangers, matters. And I've mentioned many, many times in this church that love in the religious and divine sense has to do with God and our desire and actions for the well-being of others. I didn't use wordplay yet around the well of water being in the story having to do with well-being, except, well, in the sermon, at the well of well-being. See, well-being of others is a very important aspect of this story. Indeed, as we hear most every week, it is the cornerstone of the entire Bible. It is central to Jesus' way and our faith. Last 2 weeks in our wonderful Talking About God class, we ended up discussing Meister Eckhart's claim that all living things long to be, that being is creation's quest. And we also discussed that Meister Eckhart and Paul the Apostle had theologies that included the idea that God is existence. Being itself is God. We go down to pretty heady paths in that class. I highly recommend it to anyone who's interested. Modern American theologian Marcus Borg's idea on this God is being theology can be summarized something like this. If God is omnipresent everywhere, then God cannot be separate from the universe. So the name God refers to the reality in whom we and everything exists. Dr. Borg notes that this changes the question about God. Existence. It's no longer about whether there is another being separate from the universe. Rather, the question is about the nature of reality, of what is, of isness. What is reality or isness? Does anybody want to debate that? Borg asks. The question is not, he says, whether isness is, but what isness is. The reference of the word God affirms a reality. What is ultimately a sacred reality, a more all around us, wondrous and glorious. The word God does not point to a being who may or not exist, but names what is as wondrous and sacred, a stupendous and glorious more. Marcus Borg. As the Bible puts it, God is what we live and move and have our being in. That's wonderful stuff. But there's more to it. Our lesson focuses on how we are to act in this reality once we embrace its sacredness. As Marcus Borg puts it, our relationship to the sacred, our openness to the sacred, our participation in the sacred makes possible things that otherwise might not be possible. There can be cooperation, interaction between divine purpose and human action. In our recent Talking About God classes, we've also discussed the idea that a difference between humans and other earthly life forms is that humans not only long to be, but have a drive for well-being for self and other humans and even other creatures. So we can hear Dr. Borg referring to when he mentions cooperation, interaction between divine purpose and human action. God wants calls us to one. Creation's well-being. And when we answer that call, there's cooperation, interaction between divine purpose and human action. And granted, not everyone acts on it, and some act contrary to it, but the idea of well-being for more than just ourselves is what many of us strive for, which seems unique among humans. And many humans, I like to think a great majority of us, possess a caring that transcends our family, our clan, even our species. Notably, we don't detect this as a common trait in other creatures. Humans, at our best, want more than just our own well-being. At our best, we want creation's well-being. May be what Psalm 8 in our invocation is referring to in verse 5 about humans being made a little lower than God and crowned with glory and honor. It is why Genesis declares at the start that humans are made in God's image. Our best moments. Our sense of being closer to God very often comes when we tend to or notice the well-being of one another or creation. Right? Our morals, our ethics, our laws, our art, our science, our religions are not about just being, but about having wellness in that being. And if we listen very closely in our story today, we can pick up that is its central theme. Section of the story set out in our lectionary meeting as Abraham's servant, Eliezer, reflecting on how God blessed Abraham, fighting for his well-being, giving him all that he has, including an abundance of wealth and a son. What's most telling, though, is that upon reflection, Eliezer decides that the proper spouse, the new matriarch for the Abrahamic line, will be known to him by her expression of a desire for the well-being of both himself, a stranger in a strange land, and the creatures nearby. Abraham's good living and godly ways has had ripple effects. His servant appreciates that the desire for the well-being of others is the single most
most worthy trait to judge a prospective addition to the family by. He understands that the one who will mother and nurture the grandchildren of Abraham and Sarah to further the line that is to bless all families on earth must desire the well-being of others. And that simple decision wonderfully highlights the heart of the lesson of the entire Bible, actually, which is tending to the well-being of all people and creatures is what matters. At the well, Rebekah does just that. She gets Eliezer water, she gets his camel's water. She desires the well-being for him. She shows love to a stranger and to creation, presented by the camels. And I mentioned that Eliezer observed God's love for Abraham and Abraham's love for God, but what he didn't pick up on, and what's left for us to notice, is that reciprocal love generates and attracts more love. As pickup spots, the wells were well known to be a place where maybe romantic love might blossom, but the author of this story cleverly makes it a place where love for humankind also blossoms. Every living thing mentioned or at the well is love. In addition to God's love of Abraham and Abraham's love of God, there is Abraham's parental love for Isaac, there is Eliezer's love for Abraham. And all that love is brought from Canaan to the strange land, to Ur. Once it gets to Ur and waits at the well in the form of a servant, that love triggers the idea to look for love in someone at the well in Ur. And what happens? Rebekah shows up and she creates new love at the well, love for another stranger and for other creatures. And once she tends to the well-being of Eliezer and his livestock, then she, also a stranger, is showered with blessings for her well-being, as is her family. Part of the lesson is cut out of the lecture reading. And when Rebekah is brought back to Canaan, what happens? In an arranged marriage between two caring strangers, love happens. We're told Isaac loves Rebekah and that she acted lovingly toward him. And I could stop here and just claim that all's well that ends well. But I have a few more things that I want to point out. I mentioned before that we can boil Jesus' teachings down, the very part of Christianity down, to these four basic premises. That God is love. Believe in love. Love, love, and be love. God is love. Believe in love. Love, love, and be love. Jesus was a Jewish rabbi, so it should not really be too much of a surprise that we find those teachings in the Hebrew Scripture, the Jewish stories and texts. And sure enough, it can be found in our lesson today. God is love in the story, and in fact, love soaks the whole story. Abraham believes in the God of love. Abraham loves the God of love, and he is being loved. And here's the most important part. So is Eliezer. So is Rebekah. So is Isaac. Being love in the world, bringing God to the world through love, is the whole point of our faith, the Jewish faith, and the Bible, and our lesson this morning. We can hear the pebbles of love each character drops into the well-watered being. God has these marvelous ripple effects, sending out concentric circles of love. This is a story about a well of well-being, a bottomless well of well-being. All it takes is one pebble of love plopped into life to generate ripples that just go on and on and on. Here we are, thousands of years later, touched by the ripples of love sent off at a well by a servant of Abraham. It's important to note, as we have seen over the past couple of weeks, Abraham and his family are by no means flawless in their following of God or in their being love on the earth. They are sinners. To sin is to miss the mark that God aims us as. They sin, and so do we. Humans are not perfect in time. As we discussed a couple of weeks ago, life is messy. And our job in the mess, whether we make it or someone else does or life just throws it at us, our job is to repent, which means to turn toward God. And when we turn toward God, we go to God's well of well-being, look around, see who needs watering with love, and draw love out and give it away. We need to ask, who and what can we provide better care for? And then we need to try and provide that care, regardless of our past or our awkwardness in caring. We just need to do. To use the metaphor of our lectionary lesson, is there someone, a family, a neighbor, even, no, a special, a stranger that needs us to dip into that well and provide the water of well-being to them? Or are there other parts of creation that need tending to? If there is, and there always is, we need to cooperate with God by interacting between divine purpose and human action and deliver that water of well-being to all we can, just like the hero in the story, Rebekah. We all have our thirst quenched at the well of well-being, and may we draw from that well and help quench as many other thirsts for well-being as possible. May we do this to bring about shalom, God's peace. Amen.